Hey everyone. We spent a couple of videos getting audio data into the ESP32. We're now going to switch it up a bit and get audio data out of the ESP32. I'm going to be using the MAX98357A breakout board from Adafruit. This is a Class D amplifier with an I2S interface. You need to wire up the LRC, B clock, and D in lines. Be careful not to confuse the pin labelled SD with the serial data pin. This pin is actually the shutdown and channel select pin. Make sure to use the D in pin for serial data. The amplifier needs to connect directly to a speaker. You cannot use this board as a preamp. The amount of power you can get out of the board depends on the impedance of the speaker and the voltage you supply the board. The maximum output you can achieve is 3 watts with a 5 volt power supply and a 4 ohm speaker, but this does come at the price of some audio distortion. If you want to run at 3 watts, you will need a power supply that can deliver at least 1.25 amps. You can control the amount of amplification the board provides by configuring the gain pin. In my tests, I have found that leaving the pin floating seems to cause some random noise on the output, so it may be worth experimenting in your own setup or tying the pin high or low with or without a resistor. In the video, I had the gain pin pulled down with a 100k resistor for maximum gain. The SD pin is a bit more complicated to configure and is confusingly named. A lot of other boards use SD to stand for serial data, but in this case, it's the shutdown and mode pin. If you are planning on playing mono audio, then you can leave this pin floating and simply send data on both the left and right channels simultaneously. If you tie this pin to ground, then the amplifier will be shut down. If you tie it to V in, then the amplifier will play the left channel. And to play the right channel, you need to use a pull-up resistor. The value for this resistor is slightly complicated by the fact that the board already has an internal voltage divider on this pin. I've calculated an appropriate value for the resistor for you in this table of 39 kiloohms, which should work for both 3.3 volts and 5 volts. But you may want to use a 47 kiloohm resistor if using a 5 volt power supply to be safe and allow for resistor tolerance. That's the basic wiring of the board, but what actually is a Class D amplifier? So Class D amplifiers are also known as switching amplifiers. They output a modulated signal that switches between the positive and negative power rails. This signal is passed into a low-pass filter or directly into a loudspeaker to recover the audio signal. This makes the amplifier very efficient, as the transistors are only dissipating power when they are switching from high to low and low to high. This animation demonstrates this process. We have an input sine wave coming into the system. This input signal is then converted to the PWM signal, and then we reconstruct the output by low-pass filtering the PWM signal. In this animation, I am using a very low frequency for the PWM signal, so our reconstructing signal is very noisy. The next animation shows how you can create a PWM signal. Once again, we have an input sine wave. To generate the PWM signal, we compare the input signal with a high-frequency triangle wave. When the signal is higher, we output a high, and when it is lower, we output a low. I've captured the output from the amplifier when it is being fed with a 10 kHz sine wave. To simulate the speaker acting as a low-pass filter, I've added a simple LC filter to the output and captured the filtered signal. Now, as you can see, we're able to recover the 10 kHz input sine wave from the amplifier's PWM signal. One of the nice things about this board is that it has an I2S interface. This means we can feed it a digital signal straight from the ESP32. Our entire audio path is digital up until the speaker output. Let's have a look at how the I2S interface is wired up. There are at least 3 required lines. We have the serial clock. This is used to clock data to or from the peripheral. We have a word select, also called the left-right clock or LR clock. This selects the channel that you want to send or receive data for. And finally, we have the data line. When the word select is low, data for the right channel is sent, and when it is high, data for the left channel is sent. Once again, I've captured these three lines from the ESP32 on my oscilloscope. Here we can see the left-right clock line going high and low for each channel. Here's the serial clock. I'm sending 16-bit data, so we see 16 clock cycles for each left-right clock phase. And here's the serial signal carrying the audio data encoded as 16-bit words. So that's all the wiring up taken care of. Let's have a look at the code. Here we have the I2S configuration. We'll be running in master mode and transmitting data. We'll take our sample rate from whatever is being used to generate our samples, either directly from a WAV file or from a generated signal. We'll output 16 bits for each sample, and we'll be outputting both left and right channels. This lets us support both mono and stereo sources. The stereo sources will be mixed by the amplifier board into mono. If you have two amplifier boards, then you could configure one to be the left channel and one to be the right channel, and then connect them to the same I2S pins. Sending data is pretty straightforward. We wait for the I2S peripheral to reach the end of one of its DMA buffers, and then we pull some samples from our sample generator, and then write those samples to the I2S peripheral. We need some audio data to play. The simplest format for us to use are WAV files. The header for a WAV file contains all the information we need to understand the contents of the file. We'll only try and support very basic WAV files. We need the number of channels. We can support either mono or stereo files in our code. We need the sample rate to configure the I2S peripheral. And we also need to know the bit depth. In our code, we can only support 16-bit samples, but the code could easily be extended to support other bit depths. Here's some very basic code for reading the WAV file header. We can read from the file directly into our C structure, and then pull out the details we're interested in from that C structure. And here's the basic code for reading samples from a WAV file. We seek past the header, which we know is 44 bytes, and then we can read a sample from the file. If we only have mono data, then we copy across the left channel to the right channel. Otherwise, we read in the next sample from the file for the right channel. All we need to do now is wire up the sample generator to the I2S output, and we should get audio coming out of the speaker. We store our audio files on SPIFS. To do this in platform I/O, you put them in the data folder, and then to upload the file system, you click on the platform I/O icon, and then find the ENV section of the project tasks. Scroll down, and you'll find the upload file system command. So that's it for this video. I found the MAX98357 very easy to use and a nice simple way to get audio data out of the ESP32. It's a Class D amplifier, so it's very efficient, and the I2S interface means that we are pretty much digital all the way to the speaker output. We've also seen that reading basic WAV files from SPIFS is pretty straightforward. So thanks for watching. All the source code is on GitHub. The link is in the description. If you found this video useful, please hit the subscribe button. There's more videos in the pipeline, and I'm still working on my next big project, which is getting pretty interesting. Thanks again, and I'll see you in the next video.